very central one and something which could change. But often we have very culturally local moral notions. That's right, but for Quine, even the central logical principles can be altered if with the fit of the system. So being in the centre doesn't mean not being movable. So they're all connected. So we could embrace quantum logic and change classical logic if we needed that to fit with physics. And similarly, maybe we could be forced to change our notions of obligation and right and wrong to fit with substantive notions. And in fact, some virtue theorists have argued that. They've said that the centre of philosophy should be virtues of character, Aristotelian virtues. And some of the people that argued that in the 70s and 80s said, we spend too much time thinking about obligation. And what we ought to do, we should be thinking about what kind of person we should be. So that's a case in which the core of moral thinking was changed by something outside it. So I don't mind it being structured in that way. Of course, moral thinking is like a theory we have, but it's complex. And it has different elements. And I suppose, though, that I would want to say that you cannot reject supervenience. So I would reject your principle in the following way, that if you accept any moral notion, you must accept supervenience for it. If you reject that, then you must reject the notion. So this is supposed to be absolutely necessary for thinking in moral terms. So that doesn't quite fit your picture there. But you could reject supervenience if you just forget to moralize. But for example, I don't think you have supervenience when you're thinking about niceness. So with food, for example, you have some nice food. So yesterday I went for dinner and I enjoyed watermelon juice, fresh watermelon juice. It was delicious, and it was really delicious. So I had a second. I had a second. It was so good. We don't get this in the UK, watermelon juice. I had a second one. That was also delicious. But you know, I had enough. After two was enough. So if you said, now you must have a third one, and a fourth one, and a fifth one, the sixth one, it's enough. It's not delicious. So, but it's exactly the same as the first one. Mm-hmm. So I think that a supervenience principle does not hold for our thoughts in terms of deliciousness, but it does hold for morality. So if I think, if you reject supervenience, then you really are thinking in a very different terms of niceness. Mm-hmm. Take a joke. I tell you a joke. Can't think of any jokes. I'm not very good at jokes. I tell you a joke. And you laugh. And I say, and then I tell you the same joke again. And a third time. You've already heard it. But surely it's just as funny the third time as on the first time, or is it? It's not as, you know, once you've heard it, it's no longer funny.
Yeah.
That's okay.
It's okay, it's not funny, but telling or repeating the same joke is funny.
It could be, it depends how you did it. but it seems there's not the same requirement to be consistent. In morality, you have to be consistent between similar cases. So I, yeah, so. Mm. It's weird.
In the beginning of the lecture, you mentioned the Slovenians. I want to ask a question. What's the difference between the between dependents and the Slovenians? Because sometimes I think I find is they are similarly. Yeah.
Well, dependence is, I mean, it's supposed to be, there's a dependence relation. So this depends on this property, but it doesn't necessitate, so it's supposed to be contingent. This does not necessitate that property, but this property plus some other properties does necessitate that property. So this would include properties like not stealing for starving children, negative properties. So this, the dependence is something like it's wrong because you stole it. But that doesn't make it necessary that it was wrong, because you could steal something in cases when it wasn't wrong, because you had no choice, because you had starving children at home, you had no money, it was a shop, lots of bread. But if you add everything in, then it does necessitate it. So this property here is a conjunct, dependence property is a conjunct of the property. This conjunctive property here, on which this does supervene, that's a necessary connection. So, and I have another example in the paper yesterday. That's right, the paper yesterday, I had another example. Being wrong might be dependent on stealing, but it supervenes on God's. It actually is necessitated by God thinking it's wrong. So if you think God is infallible, because he's all-knowing, then it's necessary, the case, that if God thinks it's wrong, then it is wrong. So being wrong actually supervenes on God's thinking it's wrong. But God thinking it wrong does not make it wrong. So it really has nothing to do with what makes it wrong, intuitively. So supervenience is, in a sense, it can be irrelevant. So in this case, you've got a supervenience on, and the dependent property, the depending property there is a conjunct. But in the God case, it's not even there as a conjunct of the property, God's thinking it's wrong, because that's just a necessary connection. So necessity is quite cheap. But think about this case. If Socrates exists, then 2 and 2 is 4. That's necessarily true. Think about it in possible world terms. In all possible worlds in which Socrates exists, 2 and 2 is 4. So that's necessarily true. But the truth of that necessity has got nothing to do with Socrates. Just as the truth of it being wrong to steal has got nothing to do with what God would think about it. So there are all sorts of necessary connections out there which are not really very interesting. I used to go around saying, I recommended in philosophy, no one talks about necessity and possibility for 10 years, and see how much philosophy you can do while you're not allowed to say necessary or possible. Quite a lot. because it's quite often a distraction. Necessity is sort of a weak, it's quite a weak relation between two things. It's too, maybe too weak to be very interesting. That's a bit radical thing to say, but so.
Yeah, I think Lee's real worry is concerning the connection between your last lecture and this lecture.
Yeah.
Because in the last lecture you cited that there is an ontological dependence between moral properties and natural properties. But in this lecture you try to argue that there is a natural connection.
Yes, I think there is both.
So you mean that moral properties ontologically depend on natural properties and at the same time supervene on.
Yes.
But according to your view about your logic of dependence, dependence is a contingent relation.
Yeah.
So then it should not be supervenience.
It's a different relation. Dependence and supervenience.
But supervenience implies necessity, right?
Supervenience implies necessity and dependence doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
Because dependent property is only, well, in many places it's just a conjunct of a property which, on which
all
property is supervenient.
But natural properties themselves cannot imply necessarily the moral property.
The ones that they depend on don't, but a very general one would imply.
Does they consider the case stealing something and being wrong?
Yes.
Obviously, that suppose we now consider the ontological dependence,
yeah,
we would say being wrong is dependent on,
yes,
stealing something.
Yeah.
But according to your logic, then being wrong, the relation between them is just a contingent.
Yes.
Contingent means that
it doesn't supervene on matters.
But it's not the necessary.
That's right. No, it does not supervene on being.
But if at the same time we say that being wrong is supervening on stealing something, stealing something will imply necessary.
Okay, yeah, no, that's, I would deny that probably. Yes, I can see that, why you might think that. Yeah, so I think that there is the property on which, or the fact on which the moral property or fact depends, and then there's another property on which it supervenes. They're not the same property. So actually wrongness does not supervene on stealing, because it doesn't necessitate the wrongness of stealing. But wrongness, yeah. So there are two different. So I think it is true that where there's a moral property, there's something that necessitates it, and where there's a moral property, there's something on which it depends. But those can be two different properties, but they're equally two. There are two relations there, if you like, two metaphysical relations that any moral fact stands in, both dependence and a necessitation relation. Now, I think I only
saw that the later are different.
The relata of one of them is the same, but the other relata is
the
different.
The second
relation is different, that's right. Now, I used, before I wrote that paper yesterday.
Do you have that example to show that? For example, when we consider being wrong, being wrong is dependent on stealing something.
That's right.
But when we consider supervenience, can you tell us being wrong,
yeah,
supervenient on what?
Right. It's going to be so. Suppose someone stole, a particular person stole something yesterday. There's going to be a much more general, complex, conjunctive property of that person. Is going to be, they stole it, and this, and that, and not this, and not that. It will be a conjunction. It could be this, it could be that one, but it will be a complex property, which will include the lack of excuses, And that complex property will be sufficient, or will necessitate the instantiation of the moral property.
And the properties include negative properties?
Will include the negative properties in the conjunction.
Must or might?
I think it must.
Okay.
But it will include all sorts of properties, as well as the dependence property. That's just one.
But how about a very hungry man?
Yeah.
With a child, you have to steal from the bread.
Yeah.
He's near to die.
Yeah, that's my point. So he has, I think in that case, he's perfectly okay to steal.
Yeah.
Because otherwise he's going to die. But
so
if I steal.
Not there for moral reasoning, maybe not just for like a logical reasoning, just a right or wrong, or valid or not valid. It is right, wrong, and also permissible. Morally permissible.
It could be permissible, but then that's a moral difference from being wrong.
Yeah. So how to distinguish?
Right. So stealing, but in a case where you're not hungry, the question is, or your children are not hungry, the question is, in that case, what makes it wrong? And the thought is that it's wrong because you did some stealing, but not wrong because you were not hungry.
Yeah.
So, but in order...
This is a hungry or not, this is a natural fact.
Yeah.
So, but you know,
right.
When we are, studying, especially some practical issues in the applied ethics, we will find that it's very difficult for us to make moral judgment. This is morally wrong, or this is morally obligatory. Maybe in many cases, for example, abortion, it's just a morally permissible.
Yes.
But in what situation?
I think that's.
Yeah.
I think you see.
That's a point.
You see, I think the view I've got though is very allows that different situations can be very sensitive.
Yeah.
So one person's abortion might be okay, another one maybe not, and there might be differences, subtle differences in their psychology of the mother. You know, maybe one of them is strong enough to take it, and the other one is to do with mental situations, and her medical situation is such that it's okay to have an abortion. It could be very complicated. So what that shows though is that this property here can be very complex. It could be have a whole lot of conjuncts.
Yeah.
And there's a very specific, particular situation. And that the right or wrongness of the whole thing could be necessitated or on a very complicated situation. Also, what it depends on could be more complicated than just stealing. So I think one should allow for that complexity. But there can be complexity in what makes it wrong, but there can also be complexity on the necessary conditions for it being wrong, which are not what makes it wrong. Both of them can be very complex. And I think that's right, that some things in life are complicated. Not everything is so complicated. I once went to a seminar as a graduate student. I can remember Philippa Foot.
Yeah.
She came to the seminar. My supervisor was a friend of knew her, and he invited her to the seminar. And I remember her saying that it was sort of against McDowell, but this sensitivity about feelings, what people feel like. Actually, in many cases, it's straightforward. If you embezzle money in a firm, your corruption. It's a Chinese example. If you're in the party and you take money for some contract, you've been a bad citizen, and it's not a question of feelings or anything like that. You've just done the wrong thing. So sometimes it is straightforward. They might then say, "Oh well, I had money problems, you know, they might have some excuse, but basically they've done the wrong thing. So sometimes life is very complicated. So making a decision, for example, about your career or who to marry or whether which career to go into, very complicated matter of feelings, all sorts of things, many considerations, your family, all sorts of different things to think about. But sometimes life is not so complicated, it's the right thing to do. Someone offers you, you're a professor, and someone says, look, I need this grade, here's some money to give me a good mark, or it's not so complicated in that case. Maybe difficult if you really need the money, it's difficult as far as your will goes, but morally it's straightforward.
Yeah, but when you deal with, you know, practical issues, you will find this, very, very complicated. And that is American ethicist. I don't know how to use B-E-A-U-C-H-A-M-P from Georgetown University.
Beauchamp, yeah.
Yeah, and Chavez.
That's right.
I think it's a very dominant methodology, the field of applied ethics.
Yes.
You know, they propose some fundamental principles. So
that's
this
right.
Is a four, formal principles.
Yes.
And it's a primer facie body. And it's like it's just a primer facie body. And
right.
When you deal with a practical issue, you need to do make sophistication and then make balance. And even the problem is how to.
Yes, I mean, are there these? Well, the way a lot of those practical ethics works, though, is that they are always looking for more basic principles, which explains things.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that's the problem. Why?
Yeah,
why?
This principle is enough.
I mean, sometimes there are principles. Did you know the work of who's this woman? Who does trolley problems, who wrote a book called Intricate Ethics. She's in Harvard. Francis Cam.
Her seminar course.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so, you know, when you think about these complicated cases of trolley problems, or then there's one in which you push someone off a bridge, and then you push them off the bridge with a stick, and then there's on a line, or maybe it loops back, and there's lots of, you end up, you end up sort of drunk with examples. And, and the point of, something like the Catholic doctrine of the double effect is it gives you some explanation and unifying principle. And some cases that seems like a good thing, because otherwise it's chaos. But, if you think about, of course, if you've got a practical issue which involves the law, like abortion, so you've got to say it's 24 weeks, before that okay, after that not okay, you need to make practical decisions where there's a principle at stake. But if you think about advising someone which career to go into or which partner to marry, it's much more complicated, and maybe there's more questions of gut instinct. Because it's a personal matter.
Yeah.
They find themselves, sometimes you find yourself thinking something like this, or where to go on holiday, or which car to have, where to live, which house to buy.
Yeah.
Which house to buy, right? You go into a house, you think, I don't know what it is, I have a gut feeling there's something wrong with this place. And sometimes you're tracking something right and some things you're not. Now that's no good for making the law about practical ethics, about experimenting on unborn fetuses or something. It doesn't help you there. But a lot of life is also like that. And so you want to allow quite a lot of complexity and resist principle. So someone went to Kant as an example, Ray Dankton chooses. And there's a woman who goes to Kant with a personal problem. It's quite funny, really. So there's a woman, and she's very, I think she's unhappily in love, And she writes to Immanuel Kant to ask for moral advice.
Moral advice.
And he basically says, I don't care what you feel, this is the right thing to do, something like this. And later she does kill herself. So it's an interesting case. Ray Langton discusses it. Going to Kant for everyday personal advice. No, no. Real case. Wow. So it's in his letters. Yeah, so really, you don't want to ask Kant about your personal problems.
Yeah.
But maybe you do need to ask Kant about whether you can take money. Suppose I'm short of money, and I'm looking after I'm the head of department, and I have departmental funds of, you know, several thousand, lots of money for the department. But I need to repay a debt quickly. Can I borrow some money from my department briefly, just for a week, to pay for my car insurance, which I really need? You know, then Kant will help you in that case. Mm. Kant will help you. But if you say to Kant, I've got personal problems with my romantic life, no, Kant is not the person. So I think life has both these aspects. And you need to, there's the area where it's very, very complex and difficult, and there's the area where you do need principle and theory. And the Catholic medieval doctrines try to do that. And of course they show you cannot have abortion, if they're right, because you can never do something bad as a means to achieve something good. And it explains why terror bombing is wrong. You know, you cannot kill civilians as a means to victory in the war, but you can bomb the factory where they're making armaments and kill the civilians by consequence of that. So they make the decisions. But the question is whether all of that crazy area, applied ethics, can be brought under the rule of law in that way, and I don't know, but certainly when I read Cam, I think there's something completely mad about the way she really wants to try and find a principle for every intuition.
And she tried to propose new principles.
Yeah.
Double with that, it's quite, not double, it's the tribal. Yeah.
But it's all principles accounting for intuitions about cases. So that seems wrong. I mean, think about Kant. So someone comes to you at the door and says, do you have that person hiding in your house? I want to kill them. And Kant says, you must tell them the truth. No, they have gone upstairs. And the consequence of that is this other person then goes to kill them. That's contrary to intuition. So why should intuition be sacred? You see, in that way of doing philosophy, it's reflective equilibrium in the American model with Rawls and Goodman. So you start off with intuitions about cases and you get theories which fit the intuitions. But why is that? That's a strange methodology. If we did it 3 centuries ago, we would be having intuitions about slavery, but it's a very good thing. So we would need our moral theory to fit with the practice of slavery, which is good. So we keep black people and we treat them differently, and that's my moral intuition says that's right.
But at least at least we have some share of intuitions, otherwise we can't evaluate.
You mean it's a universal value?
It might be not so universal, but we have to share something, otherwise we can't debate, we can't evaluate observance. We have, of course, we have to have some data which should be explained by your theory.
See, this is why we've got a German visiting next week. This is why, in the end, if Kant was right about his moral philosophy, it would be wonderful if he were right, because you don't need intuitions anymore. You just think, what is necessary for willing something? You know, the principle of willing anything, and you get the whole of morality out of what it is to have a will. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing culturally relative, there's nothing I have these intuitions today against or for slavery. You don't need anything universally shared. So if Kant was right, it would be amazing. If
it's an ideal society. Maybe, yeah.
Well, yeah, you could deduce it from pure reason. You can deduce morality from pure practical reasoning. But if Kant's not right, then we need something like, at least to start with, some shared moral assumptions.
So you decide the contract of truths.
Yes, that would. Yes. I don't think Kant is right, but I would like it if he was right. But unfortunately, he's not. I think there are fundamental principles of morality which don't correspond to rationality. So I think morality and rationality are different, unlike Kant. So we need some source of our knowledge of basic moral principles. And then that's a problem.
These principles are just a form without in the substantive content. I think maybe for Kant, in his opinion, the aim of ethics is totally different.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I've been very influenced by Christine Korsgaard.
Yeah.
So, I mean, how does she reason? According to Kant, this is Kant.
Yeah.
All right. We can will something, but in willing something, I've got to take the means to my end. Mm-hmm. But I must also respect my own rationality in willing something. Mm-hmm. But I take rationality in respecting it to be of value. Therefore, I must respect rationality. Therefore, I must respect rationality, whoever has it. I've given you a little argument. It's incredible. I mean, it takes you to a universal principle of rights. I mean, if it's a good argument, it's absolutely amazing, because it means rationality. People have rights that we should respect, just as I respect my own rationality. So you can get a lot of morality. That's a lot of morality. But there have been lots of societies where people didn't respect, have a notion of human rights. Most societies did not have a notion of general human rights. So the argument is probably too good to be true, because it meant that people in ancient Greece or people in ancient China, in ancient Rome, were not being properly rational. I don't believe that. So I think I think there's probably an interesting sociological question about the origin of our moral beliefs. I think monotheism plays a role in the notion of a human right.
Yeah, actually, might provide, framework according to different framework of different cultures, different communities, has their own nationality, and they have they have their own lives. People in Tibet has their logic. People in USA have their logic.
But each of these principles of rationality are equally valid.
Yeah, he's a logician, so he just tries to give a definition of what is the logic. And that they all have their own logics.
Right.
So logic,
their own logics.
Yeah, logic is defined by argument.
Argument.
And argument is relative to some background culture.
Assumptions.
Yeah.
I see. There's a real problem with how to distinguish cultural relativism and maybe moral relativism and the logic relativism. It's the same, I think.
Moral issues are not fundamental than logic ones. I think logic is more fundamental. So
logic is relative, I think.
So if logic is relative, then morality is fundamental too.
I don't think logic is relative, though. I think people have different logics, but some of them are wrong.
Yeah.
So So.
But you know, sometimes being logic and being rational means the same.
That's a question. The connection between logic and rationality. I think there are, logic is something like truth about structural truth. Yeah, they're a matter of truths of logic.
Mm-hmm.
And rationality is about how we should reason.
Yeah.
So
it's not practical.
Logic itself is not practical. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No.
But it, how we should reason.
So, rationality is not practical.
So the question is: is rationality culturally relative?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And is rationality based on certain assumptions which might, so the thing, if something else could be rational, I mean certainly some things could be rational to believe if you've got different assumptions, so presumably the medieval people were rational to believe Ptolemy astronomy, but it was false. But is rationality itself culturally relative? That's whatever beliefs and desires you begin with, rationality tells you how you should process them to produce new beliefs and desires. So that's not just a question about truths about the world. That's an interesting question. Are there basic principles of rationality which are transcultural, such as don't desire, so Kant would say yes, so
yeah.
Sort of don't desire something and also the opposite, don't believe something and also believe the opposite. So
rational be,
that's right. And so they would, so we all people in all cultures have the same principles of rationality for Kant, although they have different beliefs and different desires. So it can be rational to believe that the world goes around the sun, the earth goes around the sun, rather. It can be rational to believe that the sun revolves around the earth, and it can also be rational to believe that the earth revolves, the opposite. They can both be rational relative to our evidence. But it's this question, given your evidence, the relation between evidence and belief, if that is also relative to certain background beliefs about how we acquire evidence. Quine would say yes, because questions about acquiring beliefs on evidence are also beliefs about human beings and how they acquire knowledge. So that's why epistemology has to be naturalized. So, I don't know. Take the principle that if you seem to see something, that gives you some reason to believe it. Is that culturally relative?
More and more philosophers nowadays try to against relativism. Yeah?
No, there's something called contextualism, which is quite fashionable. So I think there's people on both sides of the debate.
Mm.
I mean, I think logic...
It's kind of radical relativism. How is it possible for radical relativism? No principle, without principle, any principle. But you know, for relativism, for radical relativism, you still, you know, have one principle. It's a tolerance.
The problem with relativism is it's something that's easy to hold as an intellectual, but hard to act on. It's again being in the room and being outside the room.
So suppose.
You know, the famous, you know, students always want to say that morality is relative. And then you say, well, what if I hit you on the nose?
Yeah.
And say, well, that's okay for me. Is that okay for you? And so, you know, as soon as the student who says in their room that everything's relative, when they go outside in the room, they have all sorts of political views which they don't think are relative. They object to their friends who stole their bicycle, and et cetera, et cetera. So no one really believes it. It's difficult to actually believe and act on the grounds of disbelief. that's the trouble. So I'm not sure what the conclusion of that is. It might be that we cannot believe it. It's difficult to rationally believe relativism. But someone might say it's still true, even though you cannot rationally believe it. What's the grounds for believing relativism? It's just the observation that you start with a sociological claim that people do accept different principles of rationality from different cultures to cultures. Yeah, I mean, but take the person who believes in astrology. I mean, you may have friends, non-academic friends, who believe in astrology, and they say, they appeal to, I'm a Scorpio, or I'm a Pisces, or a Capricorn, and they have people thinking in that way have certain principles of evidence, but they are very bad ones. So, I mean, the mere fact that there's variation does not get you to relativism. I mean, there have been slave-owning societies, but they made a mistake. Did you send me a link of this musical philosopher? Who sent me? I got a letter. I only briefly. This guy who visited. Did you send me that? I just got it and I thought, and I opened up one of the links, and there was a link about a Chinese emperor. And a famous emperor. There's a story. There are three kinds of swordsmen. But he liked to watch. He had very good sword people in his army. And when you read it, it's maybe 2,000 years old. Some famous emperor of China. And he had a lot of people good at the sword. And he used to go and watch them every day, having combat with each other to train, but many of them died. Hundreds of them would die in this training, and the king, the emperor, really enjoyed to watch this. I read this today.
He's the first emperor. Yeah, the first emperor.
Did you send me this?
Qing Dynasty.
You sent me this, did you? With these links to this aesthetician as well.
Can you find it? Yes. I don't know. I just sent you some links about music aesthetic.
That's right.
But there are many, many other things.
I just clicked another link. Not the music one time, just because I was in a hurry, I thought about it. And it had this story about this emperor.
First king.
It's the same style, this Roman emperor, Roman king.
I mean, he really enjoyed it. A really enjoyable day would be to watch his people fighting each other and killing each other. But the way it's stated. It's stated as if it's a completely normal thing to do. I mean, despite the fact that they were dying, you know, it was very good to have a strong army, and he really respected them. But he just enjoyed to watch them playing the sport.
Preference.
I mean, obviously there's social relativism there in society, you know, no conception that these were human beings who lived a whole life and some mother had brought them up and was going to be very upset when this. So there's a big change.
So there's no
truth.
But well, no, I mean, it seems to me that there are
moral truths, because obviously, clearly, we look at that and we think how incredible that he could be so morally dead, in a sense.
But how about do not kill, do no harm? Is this not universally shared?
No.
No?
They're not.
Not?
They're not shared, exactly. So, but the point is that, you can be mistaken. So we all know we can be mistaken.
So that's Jeff McMahon wrote the book, it's Ethics of Killing.
Yes.
And also Francis Kahn.
Yeah.
Talk about the, the ancient Greek.
Yeah.
The killing ethic.
In ancient Japan, no, not so ancient, in samurai Japan, if you had, it was a good thing to do. So you've got a new sword, it's a wonderful thing. So you will try it out on some peasants to see if it works well. No idea that this could be.
It's the origin of cruel human experimentation.
Well, exactly. I mean, so we see that, so I think you cannot. You have to. So obviously, there's variation sociologically, but that doesn't mean that there's moral variation. It was right for them. That's a mistake. It was wrong for them.
Yeah.
It was wrong for that samurai warrior to do that. I mean, they had a strange view in many ways. But then the I don't know if it's a Western notion of a human right would be that. At least that the peasant's life counted for something. Take when the Spanish went to South America. I mean, if you want to get shot, even if whatever you've read about the 20th century, you know about many bad things that happened in the 20th century. Some of them happened here in China. Many terrible murders and terrible things happened. Read about the Spanish in South America in 1500. There's a book you can buy, which was a letter to the Spanish king. Unbelievable massacres of the native peoples by the Spanish. Now, of course, they didn't believe that they had souls or something, the natives. But they would kill, sometimes they would come to meet them with gifts to meet the foreigners. Well, no, this is the Aztecs before the Spanish. But then that finished a long time before the European invasion. But the Spanish would go, and the native people, maybe 100 nobles, would come with gifts. And the Spanish would say, thank you very much. They would burn those people alive, and then they would kill 20,000, 30,000 natives. And they did this all over South America. In huge numbers, 20,000, 30,000, I mean, huge numbers. So this is not from the 20th century. I think Chinese Genghis Khan was also quite good at this. He was Mongolian, wasn't he?
Chengis Han.
Genghis Khan. You could kill...
Europe, yeah.
I remember reading Genghis Khan, that he asked some... Genghis Khan. He was Mongolian, not Chinese.
But
there was some city, he said, you must surrender to me. He sent his person there, and they killed him. They killed one of his messengers. So 2 years later, Genghis Khan killed 250,000 of them. Amazing. That would make everyone afraid, I think, of treating his visitors very respectfully. So I think an interesting thing about South America, though, is that this man was a priest, and he wrote to the King of Spain, says, do you understand this is happening? And it was the Catholic Jesuits who were very kind to the natives. That's because they wanted to convert them to Christianity. But they believed that they had souls, in the Christian sense, which meant that it gives everyone some rights. So this may be something to do with religion, this origin of a human right, in a way people like Francis Cam and Jeff McMahon they will not recognize, but I think they're wrong. Because the origin of this idea probably has this religious idea from the Bible. So the Catholic religious people, they went to South America and they defended the natives. And so they stopped killing so many of them after they managed to change the rules. I have a friend who works on literature, and there are many native peoples from South America, and they write in Latin, because that was the Spanish was a very oppressive language of colonialism. This is completely contrary to the United States, whereas Spanish is a minority language which is oppressed. In all of South America, it's the opposite, it's the language of colonialism. So, you know, what's the difference between the Jesuits, the religious people, and the ordinary Spanish, who went just killing tens of thousands of people, absolutely no problem. They didn't even think about it. It's like in Nanjing, perhaps. They just felt, the Japanese, let's have a competition, see how many we can. It's a sport. I think there's, the idea of a human right is an invention. And Kant is wrong about this. You cannot get it from pure reason. It comes from a religious tradition. Kant was writing in a Christian religious tradition. He was brought up as a religious Christian. And then he says, oh, I get this from pure reason. You cannot get this from pure reason. You have to, it's a substantive moral claim.
Yeah.
I think it's the correct one, but many people today, I think maybe some of the real terrorists of ISIS, they think if you're not a Muslim, you know about Islam and you won't convert to Islam, you have no rights. So they have a radically different view of rights even today. Even though they're in the Islamic tradition, which should respect rights in a way, because it comes from the Bible, I don't think, when I was reading this idea of universal human rights, I think it's a good idea. I believe in Western, this Western principle. I think it's a good invention. I'm glad we export it to other nations. It comes from the Bible 3,000 years ago. It does not come from pure reason. It does not come from... Or at least not in the way Kant says. Cannot do.
Even the conception of a human person and how to define a human person, this is essentially competitive.
Absolutely, completely agree.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But some people think if you speak to the kind of people who do CAM, Julius Savescu in Oxford, and people who do that kind of applied ethics, I think they don't really think so. Notion of a person. Maybe Peter Singer disagrees with the notion of a person, I don't know. Because I think animals aren't persons.
Yeah.
So maybe he thinks that you don't need that notion. But the notion of a person comes with it. It's a conceptual construct, but with it, it comes with certain moral boundaries and claims, doesn't it? It comes from Rome. The notion, the word person comes from ancient Rome and old Greece, and it means mask. The ancient word, but it means your role. So to be a person, it's a legal notion ultimately. So to be a person means you're subject to certain legal obligations. We can dream that Kant is right, but when you listen to, you know, in a sense, we would all like to be Kantians. Because you could prove some very real moral views, and the opposite is irrational.
Yeah.
But I don't think an ISIS killer, Al Qaeda, I don't think they're irrational. They're just different.
Yeah.
And they're morally wrong about things, but they're not being irrational.
Okay, so let's we'll just end this lecture.
Okay.
It's already 13, so time for lunch. I'll pick you up.
Thank you very much.